Live, local, breaking news. This is WYFF News 4 at 6 in high definition.
Without objection, the motion is agreed to.
In a late-night deal, Congress voted to end the government shutdown and avert a default on the nation's debt. Good evening, everyone. I'm Carol Goldsmith.
And I'm Michael Cogdill. So it is back to business in the nation's capital. Federal offices, national parks, museums across the country are now open again.
Late last night, a short-term deal was reached to increase the debt ceiling and reopen the government, at least for a while. NBC's Steve Handelsman has the latest.
As day broke in Washington, the closed signs came down. Ranger Richard Trott reopening the Korean War Memorial, and federal employees returned.
It feels great to be back to work.
Vice President Biden greeted EPA workers.
Sorry you had to go through this.
They will get back pay.
Good morning.
Secretary Tom Vilsack was outside the Department of Agriculture. Federal workers returned to the Centers for Disease Control in Atlanta. The Gateway Arch reopened in St. Louis. And back in Washington, the Air and Space Museum.
Good morning.
As the U.S. Capitol filled with tourists, Texas Tea Party Republican Senator Ted Cruz staged a photo op outside. More than any other lawmaker, say members of his own party, Cruz forced the government shutdown and near default, trying to kill Obamacare. President Obama sternly warned Congress, don't do it again.
That the American people are completely fed up with Washington. Understand that how business is done in this town has to change.
But little had changed last night as lawmakers left the Hill. They'd funded government for just 3 more months and extended the borrowing limit for less than 4 months. A new committee of lawmakers today got to work to try to prevent another crisis in January as the nation and the nation's employees tried to get over this month's crisis. I'm Steve Handelsman, NBC News, Washington.
And News 4's Mike McCormick continues our coverage live and local from the Cowpens National Battlefield. Mike, the park was able to reopen this morning.
Right, Michael, and the gate is locked up right now, but don't worry, that's only because the battlefield here, the visitor center and parking lot, usually close every night at 5 o'clock.
On October 1st, employees locked up and left. 16 days later, visitors returned because, like this park, the government shutdown is history.
When I come here every day, it's home.
Bob LeBron is a World War II veteran who volunteers here at the Cowpens National Battlefield. He used to live on part of the property but sold it to the government, so when the park closed,
I shouldn't have done that.
He felt like he'd been locked out of his own home.
It was the worst thing they could ever done. It hurt my feelings.
The shutdown was personal for Superintendent John Slaughter, too.
I came out each and every day and met with the visitors that were disappointed about not being able to visit the park, and it was tough. It was heart-wrenching.
He says the 15 employees will get back pay, but reopening was like a big bonus.
We're pretty excited about it.
The sign at the visitor center reads, "Welcome back to Cowpens."
Looking forward to seeing the battlefield and learning about the history.
Jim and Susan Camba are from Chicago.
We've had the trip planned for about 2 months, and we decided to take our chances.
They flew in this morning.
I'm feeling lucky. We should be going to a casino, I think.
Though the shutdown didn't trip up their trip, they can't ignore the fact that it did put a lot of plans in park.
I'm pretty disappointed in the government, you know, in our representatives, that they let it go this far.
And because of the shutdown, the Cowpens National Battlefield couldn't be part of the Upstate Revolutionary War weekend, but the superintendent here says the city of Gaffney stepped up and hosted the events that would have happened here. Mike McCormick, WYFF News 4, live tonight in Gaffney.
All right, Mike, thank you for that. An upstate man got into a scuffle in a Greenville courtroom after learning his sentence for a sex crime. Milano Antonio Woody was convicted of committing a lewd act on a minor and criminal sexual conduct with a minor. The victim testified that Woody began molesting her when she was 8 years old. And after the verdict today, Woody began a struggle there with court officers. He was eventually removed from the courtroom. The judge sentenced him to 15 years in prison. The Spartanburg County Sheriff's Office says this man is in some legal trouble after deputies say he admitted to hitting his daughter with his van. A deputy saw the van, pulled over Robert Nipper. They say he failed a sobriety test and actually had a blood alcohol level of 0.13. We're told Nipper said he hit his daughter by accident. Tonight he faces several charges, including DUI, open container, and assault and battery.
Deputies need your help trying to find a couple accused of breaking into storage units. Take a look. Spartanburg County investigators say the burglaries happened at two units at the Holly Springs Road storage den in Lyman. Deputies say the padlocks were cut, belongings taken. The suspects were driving a silver Honda you see in the picture here with a black primer front fender. Anyone who has information is asked to call Crime Stoppers at 888-CRIME-SC.
Taking a stand for veterans in need, that's what many people did today at an event in Spartanburg. The second annual Upstate Stand Down happened here at the Restoration Church Expo Center. This offers vets from 11 counties in the upstate and western North Carolina simply a place to get some help, with special emphasis on giving support to homeless vets and other vets who are at risk. The organizers offer a variety of services, including medical and dental care, as well as some food, clothing, and job services.